Today, I will discuss how to run a two-way ANOVA using repeated measure variables. An ANOVA is analysis of variance and is a special kind of t-test that allows us to test for multiple mean differences and determine if any of these mean differences are significant. A two-way ANOVA allows for us to determine differences between two independent variables. In this case, participants will be in all conditions since this is a repeated measures ANOVA. In a two-way ANOVA, we can not only see if the mean differences are significant, but also the interaction between the two independent variables. In this case, the effect of one independent variable may depend on the effect of the second independent variable. When discussing the two-way ANOVA, we report it as a number-by-number repeated measures ANOVA, where the numbers represent the number of levels in each independent variable. In the example today, we will discuss a 2x3 repeated measures ANOVA. So what will we be running today? First, an omnibus ANOVA will be necessary to determine if any of the mean differences are significant. Unfortunately, the overall or omnibus ANOVA will not tell between which averages there is a significant difference. Thus, we will also want to run post hoc tests that will help determine exactly where the significant differences occur. Sticking with the 2x3 repeated measures ANOVA, let's take a look at the dataset. Here, we have one column for each condition. In this case, one IV is using your left or right hand to draw a star, and the second independent variable is time, with the three levels being time 1, time 2, and time 3. This column will act as a participant number. So it's important that this first row is only data for participant 1, the second for participant 2, so on and so forth. So let's click on Analyze, General Linear Model, Repeated Measures. Next, you will need to name your repeated factors and specify the amount of levels. In this case, I will make it hand with two levels, left and right. And our second will be time with three times, 1, 2, and 3. Next, click Define. Next, we will transfer all of the columns over in the correct order so that they line up properly. You will see that the Within Subjects Variables box has numbers that indicate the condition. Here we see 1, 1, which indicates that the level for hand should be the first level, so left, and the time should be time 1. This row indicates hand 1, so left hand, time 2, left hand, time 3, so on. To drag those over, we'll click left 1, and then the arrow, left 2, and then the arrow, and so on. I'll click on plot so that I can see a graph later to help interpret these results. So I will click on plots, and then pick one IV to be on the horizontal axis. In this case, I will pick time, and the other factor to go on separate lines. Then click add and continue. Next, click on options. We will want to display means for everything. Check compare main effects, and have a confidence interval adjustment. In this case, I'll pick Bonferroni. I also want to see the descriptive statistics and the estimates of effect size. Then click Continue and OK. Now to discuss the output. First, you will see the descriptive stats box if you wish to report these values. Next, let's take a look at sphericity. We want this test to be non-significant at the 0.01 level. If we cannot meet the assumption, and in fact do have a significant test here, we will need to correct by using the Huntfeldt or greenhouse geyser values. In this case, nothing is significant at the 0.01 level, so we're good to go. Oh, it's also worth noting that hand does not have a significance level because it requires at least three levels. In this case, there's only two. Let's look at the omnibus ANOVA next, in the tests of within subjects effects. Since sphericity was assumed, we can just look at the top row for each box where it says sphericity assumed. When running a two-way ANOVA, the important box will be that interaction box at the bottom. Here, you will see that our interaction effect was significant at p is less than 0.001. Along with the degrees of freedom for the interaction and the F value. Below that, you will see the degrees of freedom for error. When reporting this omnibus ANOVA, we will report it as F degrees of freedom interaction, degrees of freedom error, equals the F value, comma P value. In this case, F of 2, comma 18 equals 47.81, P less than 0.001. Seeing that this is significant, let's figure out where all of the significant lies. First, look at the post hocs for hand. There are only two levels, so I'm a little surprised that anything came up. But either way, you can see that this independent variable by itself has significant differences at p less than 0.001. Here you will see that p value, the mean difference, and the confidence interval for that mean difference. You will also see that these two lines are actually the same, just backwards. Next, let's look at the post hocs for time. Because there are three levels, we can see how each level compares to every other level, but one at a time. Here, time 1 is compared to time 2, time 1 to time 3, time 2 to 1, time 2 to 3, time 3 to 1, and time 3 to 2. Again, this table shows the p-values, the mean differences, and the confidence intervals for each of these mini t-tests. When reporting these main effects, we will just report the p-value. In this case, people scored significantly better at time 2 than time 1. P less than 0.001. So to see a picture version of how this interaction played out, let's go ahead and interpret that graph. In this case, the left hand is blue and the right hand is green. Although people are scoring significantly higher with the right hand every time, and with each new time, people score a little better than the time before, this trend is different for the left hand versus the right hand. The left hand only gets a tiny bit better each trial, while the right hand gets significantly better each trial. This is why we see the interaction that we do. And overall, that is how to run a two-way repeated measures ANOVA.